Hello, welcome everyone to another audio software review. This time I want to look at this plugin that I just found because I was on Facebook and then it was dropped here, so you can find it on VST Planet, and it's apparently a new kick synthesizer from Chowturi DSP. And when you click on their website, then you see that this developer, even though they are very they are newcomers and everything, has already released, sorry, I just ate a pizza, has already released quite a bunch of nice plugins, like this tape, some sort of tape modeling thing, a multi-tap delay with a very interesting visualization of the taps. And I don't know what this does, a kick synthesizer that we will look at, a phaser, and some sort of VCV rack thingy. Yeah, so pretty cool. And this is a very interesting kick, and you can already hear it in this beat. So yeah, let's just check out why the sound is like this and not different. But first of all, I will make a duplicate track so that I can keep the original clean from any changes. And yeah, the first thing I do now is actually also find an alternative limiter setting where I turn this one off, because I already boosted some stuff to make it sound more exciting. So let's go back with this setting and only use this as some sort of brick wall thing for now. So now we almost only have the kick. I also used Disperser on this and FabFilter Pro Q to just get rid of the absolute lowest low end, which gets introduced a lot by Disperser. So let's just turn these two off. And now it sounds like this. And this might not sound like a kick that you would use like this, but you know, first of all, I always use effects, and especially Disperser, after every kick, no matter what the source is. And secondly, I made this patch in a way that I knew that Disperser would kind of finish it, because you know, when you know what which plugins you have, then you design your sounds with that in mind. But now let's just pretend like we only have this synthesizer and just look at it first, and we will notice that this has some sort of oscillator section and some sort of filter section. And usually when you have something like that, before we jump into this plugin, actually, what I expected this to mean when I saw it on the webpage was that there is this, well, some sort of oscillator that has a frequency, just like when you have just like when you have a kick drum that is maybe has some sort of flavor, like an 808 that is mostly defined by its sine wavy wave shapes. Just the only difference is that this is some sort of pulse kind of shape. But I expected this to work like basically constructing a kick from a wave table that looks like this. And then there would be maybe a pitch envelope. Wait, I have to give this this thing so I can play it, and then maybe some tuning, and then there is a filter. So I expected this to have some functionality like distorting, and then put a filter after that, because usually when I make kicks, I just make it like this, put an envelope on the filter, and then make it really tight. Because you can shape a kick very nicely like that. But this synthesizer actually surprised me, because the filter and the oscillator as well has a very different meaning than what you would usually think of a kick. So now I put the playback MIDI playback recording thingy on the choke kick, so that I can play it without playing back the beat. Now we can just, let's just, instead of doing this, actually removing this, and I make a fresh copy so we can work with the default state of the synthesizer. When you load it up the first time and just play back what it does, you hear this. And you might think to yourself, well, that does not go into the lowest of low ends. Kind of ends at 90 hertz, or no, this is more like 70, 50, 100, so like, yeah, I mean, it's logarithmic, so I don't know. But, well, it's not lower than 50, and a kick is usually like that. And also, there is this little confusion with these two spikes here that you usually see when you have a filter. Oops, what am I doing? Like in Serum, I think it was in Serum that when you put panning in it, no, Serum does not visualize what's going on in the filter when you put pan on it. Where have I seen it actually visualized? I think that was in this filter that was recently released, Rift filter. Yeah, there is also some sort of spread thingy, and when you have actually, oh yeah, this plugin has a little bug where it does not repaint when you have not played back stuff yet. So yeah, now, okay. And here you can see there are actually two filters, one for each channel, and you can put an offset on them, and it's often visualized like that. So I expected this to be such a thing, but it isn't. And that's good, because I was already thinking, who on earth would want to have an offset on the filter on a kick drum, because that might introduce phase issues and everything. But I was surprised, positively surprised, that this actually means something different. But what does it mean, and how can we tune this to our likings? The first impulse that I had, because the frequency was so high, was turning down the frequency. And that certainly works. You can also see it here, and you can hear it, and I hope you can also feel it. But it is quite a long sound, and at that point I thought to myself, okay, where is the envelope of this thing? And since there is only an oscillator and a filter, I thought, like, well, there is no envelope, but there is a button called decay. So what happens? But the decay button is actually a control for what the shape of the pulse is supposed to be, not the decay of the envelope. But it's cool. When you dial it up, you can make it sound more like tack tack. And when you turn down, you get more of a smoother sound. I think I like that. Amplitude? Just normal amplitude, nothing special. Even though I must say, I wish this was in decibels instead of percent. This control is really cool, the pulse width modulation width, because this is pulse, it does it has to have a pulse width modulation parameter. So, now we have a shape, and the shape sounds pretty cool, but we still have not fixed the envelope thing. So it can only be at the filter stage, right? And that was the moment when it made click to me when I tried this earlier this day, some hours ago actually just. The filter, you know, a filter can be two types for the musicians out there who don't know it. They can be infinite impulse response filters and infinite impulse response filters. And I suppose this is an infinite impulse response filter, and that is not unusual or anything. You see that a lot of times in normal filter plugins, but the thing about infinite impulse response filters is that they have a feedback loop like a delay. They are just basically very short delays with very specific properties. And this plugin kind of exaggerates this effect by giving these filters enormously amounts of feedback, and that way they create that way we can add a lot of decay, like with an envelope, to just a little impulse. So this is like an impulse. It's not, I wouldn't even call it an oscillator. It's like an impulse playback thingy. See, when we turn down the Q of the filter, then we get a lower time frame. And then it dials out very quickly. But we get the smoother sounds for on the higher values. This is more like an 808 thingy. But this is short. So what if you want to have the 808 thingy, but you want it short? Damping. But I must say, one thing that I noticed earlier already, it was that I spent a lot of time figuring out if I want 90% or 100% damping or anything in between. So I think this parameter could need another skewing, where the 90 to 100% thing is more around this whole range. Because this is almost all the same, and then it becomes interesting at more like around this point. I know, maybe it depends on the other settings, and yeah, but that was just something that I noticed earlier already with my way of using this plugin. Now there is tight, controls non-linear behavior of the filter resonance. So interesting, the second thingy shows the non-linearity-ness, whatever that means. The problem is I'm not very versed with filters yet, so that's actually the part that I don't understand about this plugin, but I understand it musically. Just listen. It gets quieter, but it also gets pokier. What if I want a very pokey kick that maybe sound like some Japanese stuff, like J-pop, you know? Then I might just try to find a sound with a very high tight setting. But the problem is I can't really get it to come back to life anymore on this tight setting. So maybe let's check the bounce knob now and see if that does something that really changes the state. And it kind of does. It adds this pew, this like hardstyle sort of flavor. And this is kind of a low pass filter, I guess. No, this is controls the response of the output tone filter. So the tone filter is a separate filter from this whole filter, I guess. And there are different modes. Linear sounds really boring. It also does not have these two parameters. So obviously, since these are about non-linearity, the linear mode does not have these parameters. I know what the linear mode is good for. I have not found a good setting on it yet, but it exists. Basic, it's the one that we already heard all the time, and bouncy. And the other kick that I made, I think I also made it in bouncy. Yes, because bouncy has a little bit more flavor. Whatever they did there, that really makes sense. That's kind of a cool sound. But I'm not in a J-pop kind of style project now. So that's a way to use this plugin, which I find really cool. It is a very interesting workflow because it reminds me of strings. Strings like on a guitar, because on a guitar there is also like this this way of thinking that there is this string that you touch, and the touch, the energy that you add to it by applying force to the string makes it vibrate, and then it just vibrates for a while until it loses all its energy due to friction with the air and stuff, and it slowly fades out. It gets dampened by the air, and this plugin feels like it's analogly modeling this, but applying the concept to something that's used for kicks, so to say, which is really cool and creative. And since it only has a bunch of controls, it also is very understandable. Another thing that I like about this is this link knob that I haven't even explored very a lot yet, but let's just do that now. When you have link enabled, the frequency knob is turned off, because now you can play different notes. And this enables us to make something like an 808 sound. Let's try that. Well, the problem now is that it's really hard to get rid of this pulse shape sort of transient. Maybe like this. Oh, that's really slow now. Now the problem is the pitch bend to the new frequency is very slow when we turn down tight. So we couldn't use it like that. But when we turn tight up too much, then the pulse shape sounds so separated from the ringing, from the filter. And that's also not cool. So maybe let's ditch the idea of an 808, or let's come back to that later when we try the presets. My next experiment is making some sort of non-bass sound with it. I think I made it. Let's forget about that. Honestly, I think something's wrong about the MIDI handling when it's set to polyphonic, because sometimes when I pressed a note, it played the note that I had pressed the last time or something like that. It's kind of weird. But you know, I was just trying to find the limits of this plugin, so this by no means meant as a critique. I would usually turn this down to voice one anyway. Now let's turn on some presets. This is a preset. Interestingly, it does not always produce the same results when I hit Q, which is a note. Now, next thing. That's a cool kick. Yeah, so this is probably as close as you can get with making an 808 sound. With this, it sometimes gets thin for some reason, and oh, it really uses the linear mode, so it really seems to be useful for something. But this is definitely not the strength of this plugin. I mean, that's kind of cute, so that's pretty cool. I might use this preset actually. Not in this beat, because it's not cute, but yeah, sounds cool. Let's go back to the kick, to the tight kick, because I wanted to make some experiments about how usable the kick is on some of the typical cases that you have with kicks. Like, let's say we have a kick. And what is often the case when you design kick sounds is that you have a kick that it comes very close before another kick with a different velocity. There is no velocity in this synthesizer yet, so that's something that I would really add. But even without the velocity thing, it's kind of a problem sometimes. That when two kicks are very close to each other, then something that fades over from the one kick could influence the next kick. And I know we have set the polyphony to one, but since the decaying is not defined by some sort of envelope of the kick or so or something, but actually by a filter that just has feedback. I suspect this to be a problem, so let's try that. I didn't hear a problem, let's try it a little bit harder. Still no problem. Still no problem. Let's try it as hard as we can. No, this really is not a problem in this synthesizer. So that's cool. The synthesizer surprises me about that. And what was the other thing that I wanted to try? Oh yeah, right. Something that is sometimes a problem with kick synthesizers is that they don't produce consistent results for each kick, but actually slightly different ones all the time. So they cannot be easily layered with another kick. So the first thing I do to check for that is actually setting an oscilloscope to beat mode and windowed or envelope. Now let's take windowed. Because the cool thing about that is that since it rewrites what's shown on the oscilloscope now every hit, if we see any motion in that, then we know that there is some imperfection going on. But I think this looked pretty static, so now I will just unfreeze this again, just let it run while I'm doing my next test, so we can just keep checking it out like for fun. And meanwhile, I try to actually layer this kick with another kick and see if that works as good as it looks. And I must say, it sounds perfect. I cannot hear any phase issues or something on some of the instances. So yeah, the plugin really, survives my tests. And it sounds really good. So, yeah. Oh yeah, and the reason why I still put disperser on it and did not just leave it dry was because disperser has this tendency to roll out the low end a little bit nicer. But it's not a problem about the synthesizer. I do that with all of my kick sources. Like when you listen to it. Which is pretty cool. And I think everyone should try that on their kicks. So now, in order to end this video, let's listen to it in full again by just turning on the original limiter setting again and then let's enjoy some beat, and then I will tell you my little conclusion about this. Oh yeah, one little thing that I have to add, because I added in every one of my audio software reviews, and that I just noticed was that the thing about the sliders, first of all, sensitive drags on CTRL in this plugin, you can drag the knobs, you can mouse wheel the knobs, you can CTRL drag the knobs for sensitive mode, and you cannot CTRL mouse wheel the knobs for sensitive mode. It just does the same as normal mouse wheel. And I don't know if this is an indicator for this plugin to be made with Juice, but this is often a common problem of Juice-based plugins. Let me try another test to see if this is Juice. What Juice often does wrong with is trying to go into sensitive mode while dragging. Now I'm dragging, and then I will start putting to sensitive mode and then keep on dragging. No, that works. Okay, so it might not be a Juice-based VST, but still a VST where the developer did not care about mouse wheel sensitive mode. I would highly suggest all developers to watch my videos, and if there is one takeaway from it, then please don't forget to implement mouse wheel sensitive mode, because sometimes I'm not making as much music anymore as I did when I was active every day. But when I was active every day and was like making music for days with only some hours of break in between, I sometimes got a little bit lazy, because on the one hand, I was so not lazy that I was working for days. But on the other hand, I was getting lazy because I was so tired. And that creates this interesting effect that at some point you get conscious about every click that you make and try to avoid it, and using mouse wheel is the way to go then. At the moment, I can barely believe that this was the case. I just use the CTRL drag when the plugin does not have mouse wheel, and I'm not mad, but I remember being mad was a thing, so I respect my past me for that and try to avoid such cases. But yeah, it seems to be not a very important thing. Actually, I am a little bit mad, actually, because, you know, sometimes the desk is limited. Like, at the moment, I try to find a decay setting that is, like, around 17% and maybe 20. So, something really fine. So, I need to use sensitive mode, right? So, now, what I'm doing now is I will, on my OBS, I will put myself on full screen now, and then I will take my webcam. and then I will show you what my desk looks like here. So I have this little setup where I'm basically just sitting here with one hand and doing something like this. Now imagine that my other hand is not currently holding my webcam, but I actually have my other hand on the CTRL button. That would mean that now every movement that I make has to be really strong to make an actual difference. And that would mean that, let's say I want to drag down, then I have to go here, and then I have to go up and go here again. And only then I can drag on. I have to keep doing that and maybe go back at some point when I notice that was a mistake and then go down again. And you know, I could also just take the keyboard and put it somewhere up here. But that would mean that I have to later take it and put it back here, because obviously I need it a lot. And I won't do that. So mouse wheel sensitive mode is important for everyone, not just for some weirdos that make music all night long, because then you can use this very limited amount of space and still use sensitive drag, okay? So that's why it's important. Please everyone be aware of that now. Yeah, I know, I should not be mad about a free plugin, because obviously it is a free plugin, but this is an appeal not on free plugin developers actually, but first of all on the frameworks. The frameworks just refrain on implementing this for no reason at all, as it is as if they have never made music themselves, which is not the case. I know that it's not the case. I know that these people have made a lot of music, but I think they kind of lost track at some point. A little bit. Not completely, a little bit. And enough so that they listen to me. So that they should listen to me, I mean. And my word to the free plugin developers is, I'm sorry that you have to suffer about that because of that. Even the commercial plugin developers sometimes make this mistake. So just to give this a little bit of perspective. This plugin that I really love to use also has the same mistake, where you have no sensitive drag on mouse wheel, and where... No, okay, the transition between sensitive drag and not sensitive drag actually works. So this is good, but it still also has no sensitive drag on mouse wheel, which is not good. And there are multiple commercial plugin developers that do this. And in Spectra's case, I think that's just because it's Juice plugin. In this case, I don't know, it's probably also a Juice plugin. So we should just say the Juice developers should change something about that. Because obviously, if no developer ever thinks about that, then maybe the framework should handle this. Just so that everyone can enjoy the plugins a little bit more without the developers, without each developer having to think about that. Because obviously they don't. And yeah, so that's the thing. And to the commercial plugin developers who still don't consider to add this to their plugins, well, you sell your plugins, you actually take money for it, so it would be cool if you implemented it. It's not like the night and day, your plugin is not probably shit just because you have not implemented it. But I mean, why would you not implement it when it just feels so much better in these cases that are probably not so rare, because not everyone wants to put their keyboard away or something like that. So I really don't see the reason why anyone who is aware of that would not do it. I can only imagine people not being aware of it and for that reason not doing it. Because I don't see a reason why anyone would argue against it. And if there is a reason, then please write it in the comments, of course. I think someone once said something like, yeah, but what if the developer does not use a mouse but actually uses a touch screen or a pen? And for that I say that's an edge case that might get more and more attention nowadays, because more and more people are making music on their mobile phones or tablets. So we certainly have to acknowledge that, but I would be surprised if there was no way to distinguish between a computer and a tablet from the code, so that you could handle that differently. So if the plugin notices that it is being used from a computer with a mouse, then it should definitely have sensitive drag. And I think at this point everyone should agree, right? Okay. Yeah, now back to this plugin, because otherwise the video is going to be too long. Maybe I should just make a video only about sensitive drag so that it's sorted out forever. But, you know. This plugin is really cool. It changed my way of thinking about kick synthesis. I'm usually rather hesitant about drum synthesizers in general, but kick synthesizers are ones that I do like oftentimes, because it is quite easy to make a good kick from synthesized methods like this. But the thing is that these methods usually work differently. Usually you have some sort of wavetable and an envelope and maybe a filter envelope and a pitch envelope and a saturation envelope, a bit crusher envelope, and you slap them all on top of each other and call it a day. But this plugin is more like you play back a very short impulse that you can shape with some peculiar knobs, and then you have a filter that also has peculiar knobs, which with which you also shape the character of the transient, but on top of that the way the pitch response works and the way the length of the kick is. So it's kind of every one of these parameters actually does multiple things at the same time, musically seen, probably unmusically seen, like in the background on the low level stuff is probably very simple, because it's described here in the tooltips as something very straightforward. But what it does musically actually has multiple values at the same time. So it is something that really needs more attention. And I think it's also a very elegant way to solve the issue of making a good kick synthesizer, because it needs less parameters than most other kick synthesizers and less visualizations, because there is not a lot of envelopes and stuff that all need their own visualization. And actually these visualizations aren't even needed, they are just there for fun, I guess. And because you can shape the tone of the kick with these parameters without actually seeing the waveform, I am very positive about that you can do that, because it is more about the flavor and not so much about what line it draws. And so yeah, that's something very positive about it. One thing that I don't understand is why the keyboard is so big, because I suppose usually you would use this plugin with link turned off so that every note has the same value, because obviously we have not managed to find really good sounds with the link turned on. It was always that there had to be a compromise about how fast the pitch can go and how the transient sounded like it actually is connected with the sustain of the filter. And there were so many compromises that it would not be a lot of fun to use in polyphonic mode. So this seems like more of a gimmick. And because it's more of a gimmick, I wonder why this takes so much screen space. And at this point, I also can say with rather much confidence that this is definitely a Juice plugin, because I just noticed that this keyboard look and feel is the one from Juice, especially with these buttons here. Yeah, so I think the developer did not think this through at this point. They just felt like, oh, a lot of synthesizers have these keyboard layouts, so I have that too. Or maybe they did that because it can also be used on a tablet. I don't know. I don't want to talk shit here. So let's just see. Windows, Mac, Linux, iOS. So yeah, it can be used on iOS. So I suppose this UI is actually here because the developer wants people with a tablet to actually play the kicks with their fingers. But even in that case, I would say, if link is not enabled, why don't you just give it a huge kick button, or call it bass? I wish I was Adam Neely, because then I could now use the sample, but I can't because that would require me to edit the video and also would be kind of a copycat thing. Anyway, yeah, so I think keyboard layouts, they make sense for polyphonic synthesizers on mobile phones, but nowadays on plugins on a computer, not so much, because MIDI comes from here. And if MIDI does not come from here, then it comes from a keyboard that is plugged in. Or it comes from, oh, that was a different synthesizer. Or it comes from, it might also come from a virtual keyboard, like in my case. So either a MIDI keyboard or a virtual keyboard, but it rarely comes from the built-in keyboard visualizer. Also, it has a lot of latency. I mean, I can understand why it has latency, because it is on the GUI side, and when you are a Juice developer, then you know things that are on the GUI side. When you want to bring them to the audio side, you have to asynchronously bring them there, and that can sometimes take a bit of time. But that should not be an excuse for a feature that is not very useful, in my opinion. Okay, these were some very hard words for a plugin that is, on first of all, free, and secondly, extremely cool. But you know, I just want to put the things out of the way that could be improved, because obviously I would love this to be updated. I would love to download an updated version of this plugin that is as cool as this one, but even cooler. And if it's not going to be improved, then I will still use it because it's cool. That's my emotion about it. And that's pretty good, I think. And if the developer wants to make a commercial version of this, then they should also consider the things that I said for that version, at least, maybe. So what can be said as a conclusion? It is a good synthesizer. It is fun to use. And I think when I will use it in the future, I will be positively surprised some more times, because it is one of these synthesizers where when you have one of the settings on a specific value, and then you change some other parameter that you thought you already knew, then it suddenly has a new meaning in that context. And that's always something that I very much appreciate about a synthesizer. Not something that is just random, but something that just changes its meaning depending on the context in a way where you will then think, ah yeah, that makes totally sense, but it's fascinating. And a lot of appreciation, and yeah, I wish this developer really the best on that journey with this kick synthesizer and with the things that are coming up ahead, because this is already very promising. Also, just on a DSP perspective, like, I'm also sometimes thinking about kick synthesizers, and the superficial way of thinking about it is always to just put everywhere lookup tables of things that sound good and then play them back. But this is like synthesizing the whole kick drum really to the core, even making the envelope from a filter instead of an envelope. Like, this is really this is a very generative way of thinking about kicks, which I find super elegant. And the sound is convincing too, so what else to say? If someone skipped forward on this video and only listened to what I just said, that would be enough.